Jnanam Paramam Dheyam. Knowledge is supreme.
Let us do one more example to get the hang of everything that we are doing. Okay. So, we are given a matrix A which looks like this. So, what is the order? So, it is 4×5, right. What we want to do is, I want to verify the rank nullity theorem. So, what is the rank nullity theorem said? For this matrix, I should find the rank, I should find nullity. What is nullity? That is the dimension of the null space. Homogeneous system Ax is equal to 0. Find dimension of that, add up, I should get equal to n, right. With m cross n matrix, I want to verify that. So, let us see what are the computations involved. Either case, first of all, we have to reduce it to the row echelon form. So, let us do that. So, this is the matrix. So, I have written down the operations, 0 here, which is missing in the typo. So, do that. This is what you get. So, in this matrix, how many pivots are there? 2, right? They are in the yellow box. There are first 2 rows which are non-zero. So, what is the rank of this matrix? 2 is the rank of this matrix. Right, the number of non-zero rows. Okay, right. So rank is equal. Now what is the next thing I want to do? I want to find nullity. So how do I find the nullity? That means I should describe the null space. I should describe all solutions of Ax is equal to 0. So if I take this matrix and write x here, x1, x2, x3, x4, so on, equal to 0. What are the equations I will get? x1 + 3x2 + x3 - 2x4 = 0, right. The next one will give me 2 × x3 x4 + x4 - x5 = 0, right. So, only 2 equations I will get. Rank is equal to 2. What is n? Equal to 5. So, how many independent variables are there? Remember, now solving the equations. If n is the number of variables, r is the rank, right, then the number of independent variables which get arbitrary values is n minus r. And what are those variables? They are precisely the non-pivotal variables. Here, what are the pivotal variables? x1 and x3. So, x1 and x3 will be computed in terms of the non-pivotal variables, that is x2, x4 and x5, right. And how they are computed? In the last equation, so what will be that equation which is last equation we got? That is 2x3 + x4 - x5 = 0. x4 and x5 are given arbitrary values, and from that equation I get my x3 is known, x, right, everything is fixed. Now compute. What is this variable which is free? That is the second one. So, now x2 gets the arbitrary value, right, and backward substitution will give me x1. So, let us do that. So, my general solution looks like this. So, when a backward substitution I do, right, so last one is solutions will be 2x5, 2x4, and this is the solution. So, what are the variables which are free? x4, x5, right, and x2. The non-pivotal ones, in terms of that, I find all the other values, right. So, this is a null space. Now, I got a solution, right, where x1, x2, x4 and x5 are arbitrary, but still I have not gotten a basis for the null space. I only described in terms of those free variables. So, how do I get a basis? So, there is a small trick involved there. What you do, how many free are there? 3 of them. So, these three variables are given, we have to give them values, right? Arbitrary. So, what I will do is, first choice I will do is as 1, 0, 0. There are three variables, right? The first variable I will give 1, which is free, the second variable 0, third variable as 0. So, I have fixed the three variables which are arbitrary as 1, 0, 0, everything else will be computed. The next choice I purposefully give as, which is independence for the three variables. What is the next independent variable? The next value you get factor 3 variable 0, 1, 0. First one was 1, 0, 0. The next one I give 1, 0, 1, 0. And the third choice I gave as 0, 0, 1. So, the three variables are free. So, first choice I give you 1, 0, 0. The next choice I give 0, 1, 0. And third choice 0, 0, 1. Then automatically I will get the corresponding vectors as linearly independent. We will check that, right. So, this is definiteness also. I can tell the computer to do that and find out, right. So, this is definiteness and computation. So, let us do. So, x2, x4 and x5, the triplet is arbitrary, right, the free variables. So, what I do? First choice is 1, 0, 0. Next choice is 0, 1, 0 and the third choice is 0, 0, 1, right. I do that and I compute V1, V2, V3, those particular solutions with these choices. So, I get these three vectors. So, the claim is these three are linearly independent and should generate everything, right. See, x5 is arbitrary. These coefficients are not important, 2 and this are not really important. You got to call 2x5 as x5. Idea is for the last, right, x5 there should be some arbitrary value. x4 is arbitrary. x3 is determined from this equation. Once you have fixed x4 and x5, you will get what is x3, because 2 is there, you have to divide by 2, na, when you solve it. See, what will be 2x3 equal to minus x4 plus x5. So, what is x3? 1 by 2. So, instead of that fraction, just multiply that by 2, just to avoid that fraction, nothing more than that. You can, basic idea is you give arbitrary values to those non-pivotal variables and compute everything in terms of them, right. I could have divided everything by 2, I would have gotten fractions, but that won't change the solution set, right. Scalar multiple won't change the solutions. Is it clear now? Okay. So, what I want to do is, want to check that V1, V2, V3, try to check that these are linearly. So, how will you check they are independent? Alpha plus beta plus gamma equal to 0, we will get a set of equations and check that alpha equal to 0, equal to beta equal to 0, gamma equal to 0. But that is only saying you are getting a linearly independent set. How do you know it is a basis? Right. Every solution, right. So, if you take some other vector which is a solution, right, of the system, then everything should be a linear combination of that. That also requires verification. Theorem says it should be so. So, what does that mean? Every solution should be a linear combination of this, right. So, let us say x1, x2, x3, x5 is a solution, right. Then a linear combination of that should also give you the solution, right. So, every solution that means you should be able to find alpha, beta and gamma, right. These are three vectors. If every solution has to be a linear combination, pick up a solution x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, right, some particular solution. We do not know what are those, right, but they are fixed. So, you have to find alpha, beta and gamma, so that is equal to alpha times the first one plus beta times, that means that system is consistent, it is solvable, that is all I have to say. You understand what I am saying or not? Okay, let me just write the last thing here. Claim, right, if x is a solution, then this x should be equal to alpha times v1 plus beta times v2 plus gamma times v3, right? That is what I have to check. Whatever be this vector x, if that is a solution, right? That means what? These alpha, beta and gamma are unknowns, right? So that means I want to show that this system is consistent basically. This system is consistent, right? Is it okay? That you know how to do that, how to show a system is consistent or not. Again going to Rho-Euclidean form and doing it, right? So I think this is the right stage to recap everything that we have done. And because next topic will be something called determinants. Yeah. So let me just recap whatever we have done till now. We started by looking at what is linear algebra. Basically we said linear algebra is study of linearity. This arises in two ways. One is system of linear equations and doing geometry in algebraic setup. So we started with looking at systems of linear equations, right, trying to find their solutions. We looked at geometric way of doing it for R2 and R3. In R2, every linear equation is a line. In R3, every linear equation of three variables is a plane. So geometrically it says that given a system of equations in the plane, two lines will either intersect at a point, so unique solution, or they will be parallel, no solution, right, or they will be coincidental, infinite number of solutions. Something similar happens in R3, two planes, right, all three planes may not intersect. If two planes will can intersect at a line, right, and those lines can intersect at a point, so all three planes can intersect at a unique point, that is a unique solution. They may not intersect, given three planes, two may intersect somewhere and other two may intersect somewhere else, so inconsistency, those lines may not cut each other at all, right. And infinite when all three planes coincide, then there are infinite, or even from one line three planes are coming up, right, like a page, pages in a book, the center thing, right, so many planes are coming out of it, right, infinite solutions for that system also. So different possibilities in R3, but we wanted to know that how the geometry can be converted into algebra. So solving a system of linear equations, first of all we said you can write in the abstract form using matrices. The coefficients of the system and the constant on the right hand side, they are important, variables are not important. So a system can be written in the matrix form as Ax equal to b. And Gauss elimination method, which we did for 2 and 3 variables, says somehow bring this system in a form where more and more number of zeros are coming in each consecutive, variables are removed one at a time, right, eliminated at a time. So that meant in the matrix we defined what is called Rho-Euclidean form of a matrix, and we looked at what are called elementary row operations. So solving that Gauss elimination method is same as saying you can apply elementary row operations, interchanging the equations, multiplying one equation by another, multiplying an equation by a non-zero scalar and adding it to another one. By this, translated into matrix form is saying that every matrix can be brought to Rho-Euclidean form, and in particular further to what is called the reduced Rho-Euclidean form. And once you do that, you are able to write down the system will have a solution if the number of non-zero rows or the pivots is equal to number of variables, then unique solution is there, right? Or if it is less, then if it is R, that is what we call as the rank. If the rank is less than the number of variables, that is n, then n minus R will get arbitrary values, and R, the pivotal variables, will be computed in terms of the other ones. So essentially when you say freedom is there of n minus R, that somehow looks at saying that degrees of freedom or dimension you can think of, the null space should have dimension n minus R, that is what eventually comes out to be for us. So we defined the rank, then we looked at the rank in terms of basis, independence and dependence of vectors, right. We looked at vector spaces, a subset V of Rn is called a vector space. If you take two vectors and add them, that is again in that set, and a scalar multiple also is back in that set. It is closed under addition and scalar multiplication. That is called a vector space. So, the solution set of a homogeneous system Ax is equal to 0 forms a vector space. That was the main aim why we started looking at vector spaces. So, and we said that the solution of Ax is equal to b can be described in terms of solutions of the homogeneous system Ax is equal to 0. By what? Solutions of the homogeneous system form a vector space. So, we will describe that vector space plus find out one particular solution of the non-homogeneous system somehow or the other. Then every solution of homogeneous system plus this particular solution give you all solutions of the system. So, it became important to describe a vector space as neatly as possible, right. So, came in the definition of what is called basis of a vector space. So, basis is a linearly independent set which should generate everything. Everything should be obtainable from that set. So, the property was linear independence and generation, or equivalently we said it could be a maximal linearly independent set or equivalently minimal set of generators. All three are equivalent ways of saying you can get everything from a finite number of vectors by linear combination. That is the definition of basis, and we said any two bases should have the same number of elements. So, we call that as the dimension, right. Bases can be different. A vector space can have more than one basis, but dimension is always fixed for that vector. That is the number of elements in that. Any two bases will have the same number of elements. Then we looked at special cases for a matrix, the null space, the row space and the column space. These three are vector spaces. How to find bases for all these three? For the row space, take the row equivalent form, the non-zero rows give you a basis for the row space. Look at the row equivalent form, look at the columns, right, the corresponding columns, right, the pivotal columns corresponding to the original one, they form a basis for the column space. For the null space, to be definite, the idea is that variables which are free, they are given that independence choice, namely 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0 and so on, depending on how many variables. If two variables are free, then we will give two choices, 1, 0 and 0, 1. If three variables are free, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0 and 0, 0, 1 and so on. They automatically generate a linearly independent set for the solution space, right. So, that is the nutshell till now. Clear to everybody? Yes. So, I think we will stop today here, because this is important. Today was an important thing because it also gave you algorithm of how to find from a given set a linearly independent set which is maximal, writing as the column vectors, right. And from a given set, finding a basis for the span, writing it as the row vectors. So, do a lot of practice for this, right. So, you get used to it. Okay. Thank you.